Well, friends, have you ever heard a sermon and missed the point? You heard the words, they went through your ears, but they didn't penetrate your mind and your heart. Now, I should be quick to admit that that is often the preacher's fault. Not always, but often. And I've been on your end of this too, all right? I was on your end of this morning when Ryan was preaching in Sunday school. And I know that I often miss the point as a listener. It's my fault, most of the time. It's my fault. I'm distracted. My mind is somewhere else. I'm preoccupied with some other event or some other priority in my heart. Maybe I even pay close attention to the sermon, but I put my own spin on it, right? There's something in the message that makes me feel uncomfortable, so I deflect it. Oh, that's exactly what so-and-so needed to hear. Ignore the fact that it's what I needed to hear. Well, you and I, if that's true of you, as it is of me, you and I are in famous company. Jesus had 12 followers, the first leaders of his church, the apostles. But before they blossom as those faithful leaders, they are forgetful listeners. They just heard Jesus explain that his blood would be poured out for them, that Jesus would give his body for them, and that Jesus would offer his body as a sacrifice, that he would be their Passover lamb. And in the very next scene of the story, in several scenes, in fact, they miss the very point of everything Jesus had just explained to them over dinner. What will Jesus do with failures like these men? Let's broaden it out, okay? What does Jesus do with his followers who fail him? With his followers who don't listen to him? With his followers who just don't get the point? Because we're distracted. Because something else is important to us. Because we see other people's sins more quickly than we see our own. Well, perhaps it shouldn't surprise us that Jesus is patient with them. Jesus encourages them. Jesus prays for them. In fact, he suffers in prayer while they are asleep. So friends, what I want you to hear as we look into Luke chapter 22 this morning, what I want you to hear, the main point I want you to get is that Jesus never gives up on his selfish, proud, distracted, and hurting disciples. Jesus never gives up on us despite our pride, our selfishness, our distractions, and the hurt that puts us to sleep. So look first in Luke chapter 22, verses 24 through 30. I want you to see here that Jesus is patient with his selfish disciples. Look first at verse 24 there in Luke chapter 22. Right after dinner, a dispute also arose among them as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. Now remember, this is just after Jesus explains that he would give his life and he would give his life for them. And in the moments that follow, they are obsessed with their own reputation, with the way they are perceived. I mean, the echoes of his words have barely faded in the room. Before they're not only interested in their own agenda, in their own name, but they're arguing amongst themselves, competing over who should be considered the greatest. And you know, this is not even the first time here in Luke 22. Earlier in Luke, back in Luke chapter 9, they had the same argument. An argument arose among them as to which of them was the greatest. Jesus taught them at the time, "He who is least among you all is the one who is great." And now Jesus has to preach that exact same message to them. Once again, pick up there in verse 25. And Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is the greater, one who reclines at table or one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at table? This is where an honored guest would sit. But I am among you, Jesus says. I am among you as the one who serves. So they've missed the point twice now. Twice they've missed the point. I mean, good thing, right? Good thing we never sin the same way twice, right? Oh, friends, here we are. We're right here in this text. Same mistakes over and over again. We hear from this pulpit, I hope, the same message over and over again. Because as Martin Luther would have said, you need to hear it again and again. And yet Jesus is patient with these disciples. First, he tells them, to be sure, you're acting like pagans. You're acting like the Gentile leaders who use their power for their own advantage, exploit their subjects, oppress them. And then these Gentile leaders, he says here, they want to be known as benefactors. They want people to look at them and say, oh, how lucky we are to have a leader like you, while they milk their subjects for everything they can take from them. Friends, Jesus' disciples are aiming at the wrong targets. They want the perception of greatness, not genuine greatness, not the actual substance of greatness, which Jesus says is found in service. They want significance without the service. They want the privileges without the price, don't they? Jesus says, oh, brothers, that is not how my kingdom works. He says, not so with you. You've got everything upside down. Yes, you have authority. He tells them more in just a moment about the authority that they will possess. But that authority is not for your own benefit. That authority is for the purpose of service. This message is part of the fabric of Luke. It's woven throughout it that leadership comes through service. Greatness is grounded in service. This is what Mary said all the way back in Luke chapter 1. In one of the verses that sets the theme for the whole book, Mary says, when she knows that she will give birth to the Son of God, Mary says, God has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. Mary said it, now Jesus says it. Jesus has said it twice. You want to be great, humble yourself and serve. Now we need to think a little bit about authority, because I suspect, if you're anything like me, that in this age, you hear the word authority and it's like you're hearing a four-letter word, okay? We have seen authority used badly. We've seen it used in corrupt ways. We've seen it used in abusive ways. I've listened to about half of Robert Caro's biography of LBJ. Okay, I know we got a library here in this city. This is kind of like his home stomping grounds. Oh my goodness. You listen to that, or read or listen to that that biography of LBJ, you will know that political corruption and abuse of power did not begin in the last 10, 15 years, okay? It has been around for a long, long time. So corrupt, abusive authority in America is not new. But at the very least now, in this internet age where everything's public, I think we know more about the abuses. Maybe we can see more than we used to be able to see. But look, friends, that is not how God designed authority. God has written authority into humanity from the very beginning. He gave Adam the responsibility of caring for the garden, of guarding the garden. Okay, that was humanity's mission, to expand it, to exercise dominion over it, over all things, and to expand that dominion to the ends of the earth. Fill the earth with God's image bearers who use their authority, who use our authority as God does. God uses authority for good. He uses it to bless. God uses authority for the good of those who are under it. How much different that is from the sort of authority we so often see today. But then in Genesis chapter 3, you knew I was going there, Adam and Eve misused their authority. They claim more authority than God had given them. And they start exercising autonomy. They place themselves outside of God's authority, and then as a result, they're placed outside of God's garden of blessing. They're exiled. But you know what, friends? Jesus, the second Adam, is not like the first Adam. He is the greatest man, the one who is fully God and fully man. And Jesus is among his disciples as one who serves them. First he washed their feet, and then he will give his life for them. He will give his body for them. He will pour out his blood for them. And in so doing, he will serve them. So brothers and sisters, do you aspire to be known as great, to be perceived as great? Then serve. Like all churches. Like all churches, we have a half dozen jobs or so. Teams that could use more servants. Okay, so we could use more help in all those different areas. If you've got questions, ask me later. Ask one of the elders or one of the deacons or somebody else who leads a team. But look, maybe the best way to serve in this congregation is not to take a job, but that can be helpful. Maybe the best way to serve in this congregation is to look around you. You can look around the brothers and sisters in this room. I'm doing it right now, and I'm thinking of ways in which I should be serving more than I am, or faithfully than I am, and am not. You look around, and you will see people who are alone, people who need encouragement, people who are hurting, people who lack physical strength, people who just need love and encouragement, and you will see then opportunities to serve, with or without a job in the church. Kids, do you look first at ways you've been untreated, that you've been treated unfairly by your siblings, maybe by your parents? Or do you look first for opportunities to serve? Do you look for opportunities to clean up messes that other people have made? I mean, I have no experience with this. I'm speaking strictly hypothetically, of course, right? All right, let me talk about myself a little bit. It occurred to me maybe 6 months ago that the words thank you roll off my lips less instinctively than they used to. Why is that? Am I just getting to be a cranky old guy? Or am I in my heart starting to have a sense of entitlement? More of a sense that I ought to be served. Less of a sense that I ought to express gratitude and serve. Lord, have mercy on me. Elders, I should speak to you, to myself, to us as well. Let us not be known as those who are entitled. Let us be known rather as those who serve. Even as we stand before the congregation and teach, let it not be for our own name, for our own reputation, for our own glory. As we stand in front of the congregation and teach, let's not worry so much about how people perceive us, but about how we can serve them, encourage them, bless them through the word. Let us use authority, brother elders, as God designed it, in order to serve, to bless those that he's entrusted to our charge. Now, you might think that Jesus would go off on his disciples. Now, that's probably what I'd do, because I'm not wired to serve. But there's good news, because Jesus is not like me. Jesus encourages these selfish disciples. Look at verses 29 and 30. Better pick up in 28, actually. You are those who have stayed with me in my trials. Okay, right after their selfish expressions of grandeur, he encourages them. You've stayed with me in my trials, and I assign to you, as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. How strange is this, that Jesus would respond to their selfishness with encouragement? It's as if he says to them, look, this nonsense that you guys are talking, this is not who you really are. You are my people, and you will one day use authority better than you've used it now. You've lived like true servants, and in living like true servants to me, Jesus says, you've lost nothing. Friends, humble service in the end is no sacrifice. You will not look back 100 years into the future, as I say so often, and regret that you served. You will not look back and see that you got cheated out of something, that you lost out on the name, the reputation, the glory you could have had. Why is that? Because, as Jesus says, you'll all have a throne and authority in my kingdom, he says to the disciples. Friends, Jesus is a sacrificial servant at this table, but did you see there in verse 29? It says in verse 29, you will sit... Father has assigned me a kingdom so that you may eat and drink at my table. The servant at this table is the Lord of a heavenly feast. He invites his disciples, and as we saw last week, all of us, to that table. Now, there are some obvious questions here. What is this kingdom, Jesus' kingdom? He uses the phrase, my kingdom, one of just a very small number of times he does that. What is this kingdom? When is this kingdom? What are the tribes, the thrones? So some say that Jesus is, when he talks about the 12 tribes of Israel, he's talking about the church. So this must mean that some sense in which the apostles are ruling over the church now as a sort of new Israel, okay? And it's true, okay? James 1:1, Jesus refers to the church as the 12 tribes of the dispersion, right? Christians are united into the true Israel. We are united into the true Israel, united into Christ, so that through Christ we experience the benefits, the promises that God made to Israel because Jesus fulfills them for us. They're fulfilled in us through Christ. But that can't be all that Jesus means here. So in Matthew 19, Jesus says, when this happens, and he says it doesn't happen right now. This happens. They sit on these 12 thrones in the new world, in the regeneration. Now, I'm not 100% sure what that refers to. I'll tell you why in a second. Does it refer to the millennium? Does it refer to the new heavens and the new earth? Either of which are times after Jesus' return? I'm not exactly sure. I do know this. The apostles' authority in the church as they are the leaders of the early church, that's just the beginning. It's just stage one, but it's not enough. There is more to Jesus' kingdom. So that when Jesus returns, he brings all of his kingdom. And with it, he brings authority to his people. And not just to the 12, to all of us. This is a new world under Jesus' authority, under Jesus' good authority in which his people finally use that authority the way that God designed. So sometime, I want to take you back and read Daniel 7. You can go there on your own. I'm just going to summarize a small portion of it. In Daniel chapter 7, Daniel sees a vision of thrones, okay? In Daniel 7, Daniel sees a vision of thrones, and then he sees a son of man. This is how Jesus often refers to himself. And he sees the son of man receive a kingdom that includes all the nations of the earth, okay? This is speaking of Jesus' universal reign over all of humanity, over the entire globe. And that kingdom lasts forever. But a couple verses later, after Jesus receives the kingdom, in Daniel chapter 7, who receives the kingdom? Anybody know this? The saints of the Most High receive the kingdom. John sees a similar vision in Revelation. So in Revelation chapter 20, the saints reign with Christ in a 1,000-year millennium. And then in chapter 22, the saints reign in the new heavens and the new earth forever. So I'm convinced that what Jesus is promising to these disciples, all of the saints share in, whenever exactly and however exactly it unfolds. And however it unfolds, Jesus invites his followers to a feast at his table and to reign in his kingdom. So yes, we are selfish, and yes, we are forgetful, but Jesus is patient. And Jesus prepares us for something better than we deserve. He prepares us to be royalty, to reign with him. But selfishness will not be the disciples' only cause of failure this night. Jesus encourages his selfish disciples. He's patient with them, but Jesus also encourages one brash and weak disciple. Here in chapter 22, beginning in verse 31. Verse 31 says, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you that he might sift you like wheat. We saw in verses 29 and 30 that Jesus has plans for the disciples' future, but Satan has plans for the disciples right now. And this is all of them. So that word you there in verse 31, Satan demanded to have you that he might sift you like wheat. Sounds like Jesus is talking exclusively to Peter, but the word you in the Greek language, the God inspired, it's plural, okay? We have second person singular pronouns and second person plural pronouns. In the English language, it's you in both, okay? And so you represents all the disciples. Satan wants to sift all of them. He wants to sift them like wheat. So you sift. Sifting means separating parts of one thing from other parts of it. With wheat, it means that you sift out the chaff. So that the chaff, the husk, is separated from the grain. It seems as if Satan wants to divide and conquer. He wants to separate the disciples and then engineer their downfall. And he'll largely succeed, at least for a time. But you see here, Satan has demanded this. Satan can't do this without divine authorization. Okay, he makes himself a brash demand as if he has authority to demand this from God. And yet he needs permission, he needs authorization from God to attack these disciples, to sift them. So Christian friend, understand this. Satan may attack you under God's authority. He may attack you, but he can't own you. In fact, God is using Satan here. If God permits an attack upon you, there's a greater purpose. God is using Satan, we might even say like a puppet, and Satan doesn't have a clue. Whenever Satan thinks he's winning, he's caught up in his own narcissistic pride, and he's really digging a deeper grave, a lake of fire for himself. Like you might remember in the book of Job, where Satan has to ask God for permission to attack Job, and God gives him permission. But it turns out, for Job's good, so that Job is able to say, I've been tested, I've been tried, I've been refined in the furnace, and I've come forth as gold. But it's not just for Job's good, it also displays God's glory. So friends, you know that if you are enduring an attack from Satan, it is accomplishing God's purposes. It is exalting God's glory. And I wonder if we can be satisfied and rejoice if we know that Satan's attacks magnify the majesty of God. Yeah, it'll be painful. It may be costly, as it surely was for Job. But God's glory is worth it. Would we be willing to suffer if we knew that it would magnify God's glory? What could be more precious to us than that? But watch then in verse 32. I know you can't see it in the English language, but all the yous in verse 32... they're singular. Satan wants to sift all the disciples. But Jesus looks at Peter in verse 32 and says, I prayed for you, Peter, singular, that your faith may not fail. And when you, Peter, when you've turned again, strengthen your brothers. Peter said to him, Lord, I am ready to go with you, both to prison and to death. Jesus said, I tell you, Peter, rooster will not crow this day until you deny three times that you know me. Peter's failure, which we'll see very soon, it will be public and it will be catastrophic. But it will not ruin him. Why? Because Jesus intercedes for him. Jesus intercedes for him, and Jesus' prayer to the Father on behalf secures Peter's future. Now, brothers and sisters, understand this. It's not just Peter that he prays for. This is the focal point of his prayer at this moment, but Jesus intercedes for you. John tells us in 1 John 2:1, we have an advocate with the Father. Who is it? It is Jesus Christ, the righteous. We learn in Hebrews chapter 7 that Jesus always lives to make intercession for us. Intercession to the Father on the basis of his shed blood, on the basis of his righteousness, that is applied to us, that redeems us. So friends, Jesus may have prayed specifically for Peter in this moment, but right now, he is praying for all of us. If you belong to Christ, he is praying for you. Jesus names you in prayer to the Father. He asks the Father to have mercy on you, to sustain you, and to welcome you home to heaven, to that feast at his table. Now Peter here, Peter thinks he's ready to die with Jesus, as he says there in verse 33. And it's true. One day he will die for Jesus, history tells us. This night he will actually draw a sword to defend Jesus. We'll see that next week. Kyle pointed out to me this week that may indicate he really is ready to be arrested and to die with Jesus when he pulls out one sword against a bunch of soldiers. But later that night, when a young girl's question threatens to expose him, he caves. He folds. Strange, isn't it? How sometimes it's easier to face the threat of force than it is to face the threat of shame. But I want to lean in on the end of verse 32. Put your eyes there, specifically on that phrase, "When you've turned again, strengthen your brothers." Return isn't coming back to a place. Like when you come back to where we are right now, then strengthen your brothers. No, return is connected in Luke's writings with repentance. So repentance means a turning from one direction in life to another. A turning away from sin, a turning to Christ. A rejection of him in rebellion, and then a turning to him in humble submission. In acknowledge of his lordship. In dependence upon his salvation that comes up to us through his blood. So if sin is rebelling against God, running from his authority, repentance and returning means I come back. I return to the Father, like the prodigal son in that passage Dana preached at Fitzhugh last week. Coming home broken, coming home empty, coming home needy and desperate, but coming home because the Father will receive me. Friend, my non-Christian friend, if you're here today and you've been running, this is the time to stop running. Your Father will receive you. I can't speak for your earthly father. What's happened between you and him, your parents, other loved ones. There may be brokenness in a relationship that you are not capable of mending. But the brokenness between you and our Heavenly Father, that is also a brokenness you cannot mend, but your Father has already taken initiative to reconcile with you. He sent his Son to make the sacrifice for your sins so that there is nothing that you have done that excludes you from his family. He welcomes you back, just like that father in the story Jesus told welcomed the prodigal who wasted his father's, the inheritance he got from his father. He wasted it in self-centered, lustful living. You come home today. Jesus will receive you. Look, I'd love to speak to you. You don't have to wait till we get to the door, but I'd love to speak to you at the door today if you need to know more of what it would look like for you to follow Jesus. But I'd plead with you right now to call out to him. Call out to him in this moment while we're hearing about Jesus' call. But Jesus says to Peter, when you return, strengthen your brothers. The word strengthen there is sterizo, the word from which we get our English language today, word steroids, okay? Something that strengthens, that can strengthen us. Think about this for a second. Peter hasn't even sinned yet, let alone turn from his sin, and Jesus is already thinking about how Peter will one day strengthen his brothers. Peter's failure will not waste his life. It won't destroy Jesus' plans for him. Okay, so your present rebellion is not so strong that God cannot overcome it. That he can't redeem you from it, that he can't once again equip you for service. In fact, Jesus doesn't just expect you to strengthen your brothers, he empowers it. He equips us to do it. Jesus is able to take you, regardless of the mess you've made in your life, and turn it around, turn it back to him, fill you with his Holy Spirit, with gifts from the Holy Spirit that will build up the body of Christ. I have a picture in my mind right now. Sitting at a table in a dining room of a kind of a mansion where a friend of mine named Ken was renting a room. It's about 18 years ago now. Sitting at the table, bumped into somebody that I'd known years before that in college who's now living, in the same place. She was over at the house along with a bunch of other friends of my friend Ken, and I happened to be there in town that weekend. And so we're catching up. We'd kind of known each other a little bit in college, not that well, swapping stories. And I don't remember what brought it up, but I remember her saying to me, you were kind of a jerk in college. That hurt, somebody else came up and interrupted the conversation, and it stuck with me for the rest of the day, the rest of the night. It stuck with me for the next 18 years, I guess. I didn't want to hear it. And I felt like, man, my first thought was, I hardly knew her in college. My second thought was, but you know, she was right. But by God's grace, he wasn't done with me then. Shortly before I moved to Meredith and I got married and I moved to High Point to be an associate pastor there, there was a pastor in a church. I knew him a little bit. I'd never been in his church, but for some reason he was praying for the pastoral ministry I was about to launch into. Not one, but two people came up to him after the service expressing concern that I was about to become a pastor. I have no idea who these people are. I'm sure I hadn't seen him in probably 15 years. But I guess they knew me that well back then. And I can't blame them for saying what they said to him. So friend, if you've wasted years with wrong priorities, as I had, return and strengthen one another. If you've disengaged from your family, you've been absorbed with your career or social media or video games or alcohol or politics or some other drug, return and strengthen one another. If you've struggled with lust, maybe been enslaved by it, return and strengthen one another. The bottom line here is that if Peter didn't ruin his life by denying his Lord, as he's about to do, by denying his Savior and denying his friend, then you haven't ruined yours. Jesus knew how you and I would fail before we even face the temptation. And he still intends to make our lives fruitful. Thanks be to God. Now, Jesus knows that we live in a difficult world. In some ways, yes, more difficult than Jerusalem in 30 AD. And so Jesus is about to prepare his disciples for the challenge of that new world. Look at verses 35 through 37 with me. Jesus said to them, "When I sent you out with no money bag or knapsack or sandals, did you lack anything?" They said, "Nothing." He said to them, "But now let the one who has a money bag take it, and likewise a knapsack. And let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me. And he was numbered with the transgressors. For what is written about me has its fulfillment." Here, Jesus prepares his distracted disciples. Jesus prepares his distracted disciples. He's explaining to them that his death initiates a new phase of life for his followers. The world is about to change around them. So when Jesus had sent them out to preach earlier in Luke chapter 9, Luke chapter 10, all their needs were met. They didn't need to carry along supplies, protection. They were in no danger. After Jesus' death, gospel ministry will continue, but it will come with hazards. The work will be difficult. Opponents, it seems, will become violent. Surely history proves that to be true. Now, when we send gospel workers out, those disciples, those followers of Jesus who go out into the harvest, they need to be prepared. They need to be shrewd. This has implications for missions. I am grateful that the missions agencies that we work with most closely, they send out missionaries with adequate funding. The missions agency that we work most closely with has extensive security operations. I wish you could see some of what it looks like. They equip the missionaries that we send out with evasion skills, with survival skills, with evacuation logistics, because they are essential. I could tell you one of the most amazing stories I've ever heard about a man who was in Pakistan on a date you might remember, September 11th, 2001. He was in the mountains hiking out to visit a town that was out nestled in the mountains of Pakistan, far from everybody else. He may have had one local traveling with him. While he was out, 9/11 happens. He comes back, doesn't know what's happened, comes to his door, and there's a note on his door, and his family's gone. The note explains what's happened. One man had stayed around to get him out. The point of that story is that while we have missions workers in dangerous places, we also have, by God's grace, a well-prepared team to get them out of trouble in the event of a catastrophic event like that. In a world like this, we need to be prepared for moments like that. But what about these swords? Yes, Jesus says they'll need a sword more than they need a cloak. So if you're looking for a passage to justify concealed carry, I think this is the verse in the Bible you've been looking for, okay? Now, hang on a second. We know Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, he says in John, what would my servants do? They'd fight, okay? A sword is not enough protection against the powers of the Roman army. It's not going to get him very far. And understand this, we do not advance Jesus' kingdom at the tip of a sword or any other weapon that you may own. Jesus also never says, when you're persecuted, you're free to retaliate. No, Jesus says in Matthew 5, when you're persecuted, rejoice. Read through the book of Acts. Okay, Paul invokes his rights as a Roman citizen, but when he and other disciples are beaten and stoned and imprisoned, you never once see them retaliating with force. So some interpreters will say, this must be figurative. Jesus is exaggerating. He's speaking hyperbolically. You know what? I'm not so sure that's true. In a violent age, is self-defense prohibited? I lament the occasions when deranged murderers attack churches. And I'm very grateful for members of our safety team who are ready to put themselves in harm's way, who are ready to find a way to neutralize a threat to us, to buy us time in the event that something like that happens to us, to protect our kids. So we are not, in that sense, pacifists, but neither are we aggressors. Whatever exactly the sword is for, what's clear is that we should not be surprised if the world hates Jesus' people. In fact, Jesus says there that it fulfills Scripture. He's quoting from the passage we read earlier, Isaiah 53:12, that the suffering servant would be numbered with the transgressors. Jesus is just about to be treated like a criminal, to be executed, surrounded by criminals. Just as Jesus said, if the world hates you, in John 15, know that it hated me before it hated you. And if the disciples had just stopped to think about what Jesus had said there, the scripture must be fulfilled that the Son of Man is numbered with the transgressors. If they'd stopped and thought about it, they would have realized that Jesus, in being numbered with the transgressors, that's how he atones for our sin. He is treated like an unjust, wicked criminal so that we could be treated like God's righteous children. Even read at the end of Isaiah 53, and we find that there is victory in Jesus' death with transgressors. He receives spoil. He receives the kingdom that he's talking about that earlier there in the chapter. But look in particular at verse 38. I need to read this to you. The disciples said, look, Lord, here are two swords. And he said to them, it is enough. So while Jesus is saying that he would be treated like a criminal for them, here they are, inventorying their swords, evaluating their arsenal. And when Jesus says, it is enough, he's not saying, that's how you'll beat Rome. That's how you'll fight off the Jewish religious leaders. No, he's saying, enough of this. Brothers, how could you miss the point again? That it is through me being numbered as one of the transgressors that you receive a verdict of not guilty. You receive a verdict of righteous before God. Friends, beware our impulse to rely on self-defense. While it has a place, it can also distract us. It can tempt us, as it does the disciples here, to forget Jesus, to trust our own strength, our own might. That's what happens next to the disciples. They have their swords, but they don't listen to Jesus. Look at verse 39. And came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives. And the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, saying, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping for sorrow. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Rise and pray that you may not enter into temptation." Here we see, once again, Jesus serving his disciples. Here he models trust. Trust in the Father. Jesus models trust through suffering for his grieving disciples, his hurting disciples. Jesus knows that his disciples will soon face a severe test. So he encourages them to pray that they would not enter into temptation. What will happen? Will they abandon him? Will they deny him? Will faith fail them? Surely Jesus knows. Surely Jesus knows that their swords will not protect them from this temptation. Only prayer. Meanwhile, Jesus faces another kind of test. Not a temptation, not here. Not even agony. Though verses 43 to 44 describe terrible agony. Simply in anticipation of the coming suffering. The kind of test that Jesus faces specifically isn't the pain. It is a cup. You see that where he prays? Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Jesus dreads this cup. What's he mean by this cup? There are several Old Testament passages that describe in the same kind of language God's cup. And I'm convinced this is the cup that Jesus is referring to. I'll just take you to one in the 75th Psalm, Psalm 75:8. The psalmist speaks and says, "In the hand of the Lord there is a cup with foaming wine well mixed. And he, the Lord, pours out from it, and all the wicked of the earth shall drain it down to the dregs." Keep reading in other passages, Isaiah 51 and Zechariah and elsewhere. Cup is a picture of God's judgment. The cup is a picture of how God pours into the throat of the wicked his wrath, his just judgment upon human sin, so that those who persist in rebellion against him, those who violate his laws, drink it all down to the dregs, down to the very bottom. But here in Luke 22, it's not the wicked who are drinking the cup. It is the perfect, holy Son of God. As we sang in Jesus, thank you, he drank the bitter cup reserved for me. So Jesus isn't wicked, but he drinks the cup. He drinks it as our substitute. One commentator, Dale Ralph Davis, put it this way. He drinks the cup of wrath in order that he can offer you, the cup of blessing. Or even as God says in the book of Hebrews, by the grace of God, he tasted death for everyone. So that Jesus tastes the penalty for your sin, so that you can taste the wine of his table, so that you can taste his righteousness, his redemption, his freedom, and his exaltation. You get what he deserves. Now understand here, friends, don't imagine that Jesus suffered merely physically. You can see his humanity wrestling with what's about to unfold, and the worst of it is that he faces judgment from the hand of his Father, who gives him that cup. This is not divine child abuse, as some try to say. Jesus, I think we could say reluctantly, Jesus reluctantly but willingly and with determination trusts and submits to his Father's good authority. He embraces it. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. The disciples don't pray. They don't pray because they're in sorrow. Instead, they sleep. It seems that they now understand that Jesus will die. Finally, it's gotten through to them. And they grieve, but they fail to pray. Jesus prays through his sorrow as they sleep, and as he anticipates more sorrow to come. So friends, let us pray. Have you ever been tempted and prayed and kept on and gone ahead and sinned while you're praying? It's tough to do. I'm not saying it's impossible, but it's very difficult to sin while you're speaking to the Lord, imploring him to help you in fighting your sin. So when you're tempted, pray that you might be delivered. So we see here, throughout this passage, that Jesus never gives up on his proud, distracted, hurting disciples. Jesus receives the one who returns to him and equips him to serve others. So understand this, brothers and sisters, Jesus will never give up on you if you return to him. You may feel like a failure. There's probably a reason for that. Probably because you are. Probably because I am. You'll feel like a failure when you've failed. But remember this passage. Return to this passage. Find in this passage, in Jesus' words, find a reminder that Jesus is patient with you. Find encouragement in his plans for you. Find preparation for a dangerous age. And then find strength for suffering, for grief, in Jesus' prayer. Let us pray. Father, apart from the gracious ministry of Christ poured out to us in your Holy Spirit, we are not ready for what faces us in this age. We are often seduced by our own hearts. We are selfish, we are proud, we are unprepared, and we are weak. We are often prayerless. Father, we confess our sin and we plead for mercy. We plead for power, the power that you've promised us in Christ through your Spirit. Have mercy on us. May your Spirit point us back to Christ again and again and again. We pray in Jesus' name.